To begin this episode, we have Super Mario Land. As you'll see, I have two playthroughs recorded on two different consoles, for the GameCube Game Boy Player and on the Super Nintendo for the Super Game Boy. I'll get into why later. I believe the first Game Boy game I ever played was my uncle's Super Mario Land 2, but when he didn't want his Game Boy games anymore and I took them, there was one of those 105 games in one bootlegs. It had only about 10 games, just repeated with different names on the menu, and this was one of them. This was one my brother would play more, and he would get quite angry at it. He destroyed two Game Boy Colors when getting mad at this game, first my turquoise one and then his own yellow one. I myself never managed to beat this game before recording it for this video, but I did make it to the final boss many times. Rather than the usual Mushroom Kingdom, this game takes place in Sarasaland. Its four kingdoms have been invaded by the alien Tatanga, who has also captured Princess Daisy, making her first ever appearance. And Mario's just gotta deal with it, starting with World 1-1 in the Birabuto Kingdom. The gameplay is very similar to the original Super Mario Bros, but slightly different with the way Mario feels control. Still got super mushrooms to make him big. Most of the enemies are either unique to this game, or exclusive subspecies of existing Mario enemies such as the Goomba. These are simply smaller Goombas and function the same. Flowers are still the second stage of power-up. Rather than the Fire Flower, we have the Super Ball Flower. This allows you to throw Super Balls that move diagonally in a straight line and bounce off surfaces. You can only fire one Super Ball at a time though, and have to wait for the first to leave the screen. There's still the underground areas through pipes with loads of coins inside too. Another thing the Super Balls can do is collect any coins they touch. Once I get out of the pipe, I meet and immediately kill another enemy, the Fly from the original arcade Mario Bros. And like Super Mario Bros, taking damage reduces to small Mario regardless of current form. The Star Man is still in the game, and strangely enough, it doesn't use the usual star theme. Instead, it's a short bit from Gallop Infernal, the one everyone just calls the Can-Can. Thinking about it, this may actually be the first place I ever heard this particular bit of music. Confused the hell out of me when I was 7. Each regular level has two exits, a door at the bottom and a harder to reach one at the top involving moving platforms. Taking this exit allows you to play the bonus game. Mario and a ladder move down between four floors and have to time the button press to choose the floor. The possible rewards are up to 3 lives or a flower. As you can see, I picked the floor with 3 lives, but the ladder lands there too and makes me take a flower I don't need. World 1-2 is similar to those high up levels in SMB1, like it's World 1-3. A new enemy is the Boon that flies along the screen, stopping to throw a spear straight down. One enemy on the first level I didn't bring up is the Bombshell Cooper. No shell kicking in this game, jumping on one has it retreat into its shell to blow itself up. A little after them I fall in a pit and die. All this weird stuff and me first playing it on a bootleg multicart did have me thinking back then that maybe this game was some kind of bootleg. Nowadays I enjoy the weirder aspects of this game. Another thing I'd like to bring up is this music for the Birabuto Kingdom. I really like it and I'm still so salty that of all tracks in this game to put in Smash, the only one they chose was the underground theme. It's not a bad track, but I'd say half of this game's soundtrack vastly outclasses it. Another thing for the weird pile is the 1-ups. Can't have the green mushrooms in black and white, so 1-ups in this game and its sequel are hearts. That's about it and I get the bonus exit at the end. This time I get my free 1-ups. World 1-3 has us underground with that theme I mentioned that got in Smash. Once again, I don't dislike it, but there are others I prefer far more. We have piranha plants, no special variant. The manual did leave their names untranslated as Pakun Flower though, tricking some of us, myself included, into thinking they were a new type. We also have fallen slabs from the ceiling. The colour palette on the Game Boy Player gives them away, but on the Super Game Boy they were the same colour as all the others. Another new enemy, Gao. These little sphinx things spit their own diagonal fireballs at you. After it, there's a section where you actually lose out if you're big. You could go through a small tunnel and get a load of coins, including a mushroom when you're done. One of the few times where it's just straight up better to be small in this series. After some falling tiles and a couple more Gao, I meet this game's first boss, King Totomesu. He's pretty much just like the Bowsers in SMB1. He jumps up and down on a bridge, spitting fireballs while you have the option of killing him with projectiles or reaching the end of the bridge to press the button that kills him. I go with the Super Ball since it doesn't take many. Mario finds Daisy, who turns out to be a fly that hops away. That's this game's The Princess is in Another Castle. All level 3s in the world automatically give you the bonus game at the end. I get one extra life. It seems Mario took a flying saucer to the Muda Kingdom for World 2-1. Another track that's just so much better than the one chosen for Smash. Here we have Honen jumping from the water. Jumping kills them, but they're immune to Super Balls. Most of this level is spent traversing platforms over the water, whether they're hills or normal moving platforms. I do have a moment where Honen goes right through me without damaging me, don't get why. Not long after I get a star and just get moving, since stars feel like they last longer in this game, or maybe it's just me. During this I meet my first Yurarin Boo. These jump from the water to spit fireballs at me. After my star runs out, one of them even gets me right in the face. It means I can't break the block keeping me from a 1-up right before the end of the level. I get the bonus exit and win 2 lives. World 2-2 keeps me above water and introduces the Mechabon enemy. Apparently they throw their heads, but these enemies are so low in number and I kill them so quickly I don't think I've ever seen it happen. Well, until the very next one, which I completely forgot about because this was recorded 3 years ago. It even damages me because I wait until the one small moment it was possible for me to take damage from it and threw myself into it. Shame too, because there's now this row of blocks I can't break, just taunting me. At the end of the first row is a star though, so I just belt it as fast as I can through the level and jump into the easiest pit to avoid in the game. Lucky for me, this game is very generous with its checkpoints, usually having multiple in a single level. Then a Yurarin Boo snipes me long after he'd left the screen. At the checkpoint, I enter a pipe instead and end up jumping around randomly waiting for the invisible block that would get me up to the pipe. Unlike SMB1, these secret underground sections don't spit you out later in the level, just from the same pipe you entered from. After that is the end. I mess up on the falling platforms and have to take the normal exit, no bonus for me. World 2-3 is a change of pace. We're underwater in Mario's submarine, the Marine Pop. I can have up to 3 bullets on screen at once and can shoot power-ups out of blocks. We have some exclusive enemies here, like Vitorion. They'll swim towards you and if you don't shoot them, they'll turn around and try ramming you from behind. We have regular Urarins who just swim diagonally. They're a little like bloopers but they just keep going off screen if they miss you. Finally there's Igunion. When killed, they'll explode into 2 fireballs that come towards you, so keep a distance when killing them. And after that, it's walls of blocks to shoot through and Mario's name spelled in coins. A little after that is the second boss, Dragon Zamasu. No, this isn't some shitty overdesigned Dragon Ball Heroes, what if? It'll move up and down spitting fireballs all backed up by this big moving bubble, Tamao. It's very easy, just moving up and avoiding its fire and spamming torpedoes that it kills it quick. Then I have to shoot through the blocks at the bottom to reach the switch end of the level. This time, Daisy turns into a Gunion that hops away. From the bonus, I win 3 1-ups. World 3-1 has us in the Easton Kingdom, as shown by the giant Moai in the background, and the flying one coming towards me, the Batadon. We also have Bullet Bills. In this game, their blasters pop in and out of pipes before firing. Like the piranha plants, these are another enemy that were just listed as their Japanese name in the manual, so people like me thought they were a new species for years. After crossing some pits with some moving platforms, for some reason I short hop into one. After these jumps, there's this one drop above the small pit with loads of coins that I have never fallen into, but it terrifies me every time. Then after jumping over a Koopa, I die falling into the face of a Toko Toko. Their deal is simply that they run very fast from one side of the screen to the other. It's at this point that the Batadons become a little more awkward to deal with thanks to the layout of these platforms. After some more moving platforms, I get one of those moments I hate in Mario games, where the block sends a mushroom right towards a pit. No matter how old I get or how much better I get at these games, I never get over those moments. It also means I die running full speed opposite a trio of Toko Toko and can't react in time. This means I'm sure I'll get the mushroom but end up falling into a pit alongside it. I still miss it the third try and manage to land underneath a falling Batadon. I actually get the mushroom this time. After running past a load of Batadons and Bullet Bills, I reach a spike pit where I have to ride the Ganchan across. Yeah, these are actual characters with names and not just boulders. Not much else to say about this bit, just got multiple spike pits to ride across, taking me to the exit. I failed to reach the bonus again. World 3-2 has us underground again. Probably my least favourite level in the game, it's just really long. New enemy here, we have Sue. These spiders just drop from the ceiling when you get close. They're easy to deal with, just lower them down and then jump on them. I will say, when I'm playing, that these waterfalls in the background really throw me off when I'm in front of them. Another new enemy, Kumo, another spider that jumps towards you. Now, Kumo is simply the Japanese word for spider, so you'd think it was another one they just left the name untranslated. But no, they have a different name in Japan. So whoever localised the enemy names went, this Japanese term can't stay for the West, it must be a completely different untranslated Japanese word instead. That makes more sense. It killed me while I was saying that, by the way. I think this was the level that always kicked off my brother's rage, thanks to its ridiculous length. It's also another reason this one is my least favourite. This level took my turquoise Game Boy Color I got for my 7th birthday from me. This time I die in the same spot. I kill the Kumo, but when trying to get a mushroom, I hit the corner of the last block and bounce into a pit. Next time I get my mushroom, and the jump right after with the tiny platform and Sue waiting for me was a little nerve-wracking. Some of these tiny platforms also have falling spikes above me, so I have to move quick. A little after that, I die when for some reason I just let myself bounce off a Koopa into another pit. I do a smart next time. Sadly, bombshell Koopa explosions can't kill other enemies. It's only when I'm stuck in a corner and have a Sue rubbing against me do I realise how big these spiders must be if they're bigger than large Mario. That's terrifying. I don't even know what I was doing with my next death. I think the issue is me using a GameCube controller. This game wasn't made to be controlled with a stick. I did a lot better on the Super Nintendo. I now have multiple spike pits floating above actual pits to ride some Ganchan across. By the time I reach these falling platforms leading to the end of the level, I didn't feel like even trying to get the bonus, so I just finish it. World 3-3 has us in the air, but still with the underground theme playing. We start with a stretch of moving platforms over a huge pit. When I reach some solid ground, I'm killed right away by a Ganchan. Then I miss the very next platform and die again. Twice. Next time I don't even get to fail, I slip off the floor beforehand. Last life. I make it past the Ganchan this time and keep going. Thankfully I reach this higher up platform with a hidden 1-up. then more moving platforms where I fuck up and lose said 1-up. 1-ups respawn on death though, so I'm not in danger of game over in this small section. Then comes a maze of blocks and moving platforms along the bottom to navigate. I fail to get the timing right and miss the first platform. I get it next time. The second platform is worse since you have a bigger drop to time, but I get it first try. Sadly, I have a Toko Toko ram itself into me. Game over. I do have one continue though, even starting back at the beginning of the level and not the entire world. This time, on my way back through, I reach this pipe I failed to get up to before and go down for a nice room filled with loads of coins so I can get an extra life. Add the other one a little later and I'm safer than I was when I first reached this level. I'm prepared for the Toko Toko this time so I can avoid it. I even managed to get my first Super Ball flower in a while now. After that is the third boss, Hioi Hoi. He continuously throws Ganchans at you with the intended method of defeat being to jump off them over him and hit the switch to win the level. Instead, when I get hit, I use this game's longer than usual post-damage invincibility to run right through him and hit the switch. For this one, Daisy turns into a Kumo that jumps away. From the bonus, I then get 3 more lives. Final world, the Chai Kingdom. This is where Tatanga has the real Daisy. After getting through some plants with piranha plants in a tight space, I meet my first new enemy of this world. Pyompi are this little Zhangxi that hop around like the flies and Kumos, but when jumped on they don't stay dead. They'll rise up again and keep going unless you kill them with Super Balls or a star, or they fall in a pit. I learn this when I very nearly get hit when one gets back up. Lucky for me, I was dodging a bullet bill and landed right back on it. One slightly tricky part is a series of pipes filled with piranha plants and bill blasters. When we get to some moving platforms over a pit, I die when I forget to jump and just run right off the edge. After it is more tight spaces filled with pipes, but there's also bullet bills now too. After that is a series of falling blocks above the pit and I end up falling in. I get past it next time, which leads to a set of stairs made of pipes with bullet bills and pyompies to deal with. A little later we get an even crueler one with 3 bill blasters and a bombshell cooper between 2 of them, followed by 3 pyompies and another trio of bill blasters in pipes leading to the end of the level. I even manage to get the bonus where I get 3 lives. World 4-2 has me above water and introduces the Pompon Flower. These are like the panthers from Super Mario Bros. 2, moving back and forth spitting out fireballs, but they're much wider and take up more space, especially this one taking up most of the platform I'm required to get across. I jump just a little too late and get fireballed to death. Turns out you can't actually jump on them if they aren't spitting fire, I wouldn't have guessed. Right after that is the first Nyololin. They function identically to the Gao but are just snakes instead. They can also spit fireballs at the backs of their heads somehow. It kills me. I now have more tight spaces filled with pipes, piranha plants and bill blasters. After that they've added these fireballs spinning around a block, a bit like the roto discs in Super Mario Bros. 3. After going through a few of them I find a block with a star on it, but the block bounces me into a Koopa's face and kills me. I get it next time. You know what's cruel? Giving me a star so I can run full speed, but then slowing me down with careful moving platform stuff. There's 2 of these in a row so I don't get to do much running right through shit. It runs out just as the moving platforms stop, letting me get killed by a Nyololin. Next death, I don't know why I did that. Once I get past the Nyololin, things go much simpler and I reach the end of the level. I even get the final bonus, just 1-1-up though. Final level, World 4-3, has us in the Sky Pop. It functions the same as the Marine Pop, but I'm in the sky instead of underwater. We got some new enemies for this. There's chickens who will simply fly in a straight line but then swerve towards you if you don't kill them in time. There's the Rockaton, who if not killed will fire a bullet bill from behind at you. You'll have to dodge it because you can't fire behind. There's Ichikako, that simply float around a bit and can only be killed by a star, or 10 shots if you have the time and patience. After a while, I enter a maze of blocks that makes it harder to avoid enemies. The game also gives me a room filled with coins for a free extra life. After the coins, I have more fireballs to avoid and a couple of Genkosu, these crushing hands that come out of the pipes. After them is the fourth boss, Byokinton. It will float around firing chickens at me. To avoid being ganged upon by swerving chickens, the best way to deal with it is to get right in front of it and keep spamming fire, because you'll take out all the chickens as they come out. After 20 hits, it will be destroyed, revealing Tatanga in his own shape, the Pagosu. Tatanga flies up and down the screen firing one large fireball that splits into 3. Honestly, the best way to deal with him is to just calmly go up and down slightly whenever he fires to avoid the middle fireball and keep firing yourself, waiting for those moments he'll fly into your shots. In my experience, actually pursuing him tends to lead to death as I let myself get hit more often. It takes 25 hits to take him out. Mario finds the real Daisy who thanks him with what I guess is a hug or a kiss, there's very limited animation, and Mario takes off with her as the best bit of music across both Mario Land games plays, probably one of the best music tracks on the Game Boy as a whole. What I didn't know back then in 2018 was that I wasn't done. There's an extra second run with higher difficulty after beating the game. After finding out about it, I put it off and decided I'd get back to it when it became time to make this video, meaning I finally got around to it on the 18th of April 2021. By this time I had a Super Game Boy to make it look better too. Now some may be thinking, if you had to play the entire game again on the Super Game Boy, why not just use that footage and leave out the awful Game Boy Player recording? It's a very good point, but come on. That first recording was my first time beating a game I couldn't as a kid. I need to come across as a relatable human being somehow, and video games is all I have for that. My first retry didn't go so well, as this happened. Yeah, my Super Nintendo is old, badly taken care of, temperamental, and possibly pissed on. If I'd known I would have a perfectly functional Super Famicom at the time, I would have bought a Japanese Super Game Boy instead. I'd do much better than on my first recording, getting no game overs and finishing the game with 16 extra lives remaining. At the title screen, the mushroom icon has been replaced with Mario's face, indicating the expert mode. Mainly, enemies are a little faster and enemy layouts are harder, such as Gao being in World 1-1 instead of exclusive to 1-3 like they are normally. Another example is Dragon Zamasu being backed up by two Tamao instead of just one. But overall, it's not too much harder and I beat the game again with only one life less than last time. After returning to the title screen this time, you're now allowed to choose the world you want to start at again. Super Mario Land is a strange one. I like it, but not as much as the other two Mario platformers I've done already. It's not just the setting and music and enemies that make everything so weird, it's the controls too. There's something that feels very similar to the first SMB, but just a bit off, which leads me playing very cautiously. It's also on the short side too at just 12 levels long, but most of those 12 levels are enjoyable, and once you get used to the way it feels, it's a fun half hour. I like to champion obscure characters in long-running series for a comeback, so I'm gonna go with Tatanga and King Totomesu for my desired comeback from this game. This is one of those games like Toy Story 2, Pac-Man World, and Beavis and Butthead where it's just really good to get the closure on a game I couldn't beat as a kid. One last thing before I go. On my last two videos you may have noticed a change in the music on my rankings. I've brought this up in descriptions, but I know not everyone reads those, so I may as well address it. After uploading the first two parts of episode B5, I was getting copyright claims from Warner Brothers over using the Soul Chamber from Mortal Kombat 3. This gave me the chance to swap out the music ranking on the last two parts in advance since I hadn't started uploading them yet. Ever since this, previous videos have been getting randomly hit from the copyright claims too, leading to those being muted too. There doesn't seem to be an order to this, just every two or three days another video gets hit. So from now on, the ranking will use Crimson Fighter from East 8. This is because most of Falcom's music is royalty free, and they're fine with it as long as you list their copyright somewhere. It probably doesn't give the same feel as using the Soul Chamber, but this was a very last minute change.